Hello dear students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Gagandeep Kaur, Assistant Professor, Khalsa College of Education, Ranjit Avenue, Amritsar. Today we will discuss the topic Regulations, Accountability Mechanisms, Regulatory Bodies Guiding the Education System. After studying this module, learners will be able to clarify the concept of regulation in relation to educational system, to clarify the concept of accountability mechanisms in relation to educational system, to enhance the knowledge of students regarding the functioning of regulatory bodies in developing accountability and regulatory mechanisms, to make the students aware about the present status of our education system, to enable the student to understand the regulatory and accountability structure at elementary level, to give the knowledge regarding the regulatory structure at secondary level, to enable the student to understand the regulatory structure at higher education level. Well students, first of all, we will discuss about the journal scenario in our country. About 74% of the country's total population is literate, that is able to both read and write. Our country faces many challenges such as poor quality of education at all levels, low quality of research, inadequate basic physical infrastructure, low quality of training, lack of autonomy and accountability. So, different regulatory bodies came into existence in order to enhance the quality of education in the whole country. Well, students, here you should understand the basic terms. So, what is the meaning of term regulation? Regulations are enforced usually by a regulatory agency formed or mandated to carry out the purpose or provisions of legislation. Second term we used here is accountability. Accountability refers to the process by which the education system holds itself responsible for delivering the appropriate services and for meeting the goals for educating students. So, accountability can broadly be defined as the obligation of those holding power to take responsibility for their behaviors and actions. This obligation might come out of moral, ethical need to account for one's behavior or out of a legal requirement. It is a relational concept as it concerns the relationship between those that perform an action or deliver a service and those on whom the action or service has an effect. So, accountability involves two critical aspects. First is determining who should be accountable to whom and for what. Second is developing the institutional mechanisms and incentive sanction structures on the basis of which accountability is realized. Well, there are various elements that come together in the notion of accountability, which includes answerability, that is the need for justification of actions, enforcement, the sanctions that could be imposed if the actions or justification for the actions are found to be unsatisfactory, and responsiveness, that is the ability of those held accountable to respond to the demands made. Well, accountability requires transparency so that actions can be scrutinized and to assess the performance. So, I hope both the terms are clear to you. It is important to know about the regulatory framework at each level of education, that is elementary, secondary and higher education. Well students, now we will discuss about the present status of our educational system in the country. Our India's educational system broadly comprises of school education, that is the elementary, secondary and higher education. The Ministry of Human Resource Development, MHRD, is the nodal ministry for the sector. Well students, the bodies which regulate our educational process works at different level, that is at the center level and at the state level. The bodies involved in regulating and maintaining standards at the center level are like NCERT, that is the National Council of Educational Research and Training, UGC, that is University Grants Commission, NCTE, that is National Council for Teacher Education, NUPA, that is National University of Educational Planning and Administration at the central level. Well, the bodies which regulate the educational process at the state level are like the Department of Education and the State Council of Educational Research and Training, that is SCERTs. So, all these educational bodies have developed some important regulations and accountability mechanisms in order to improve the system. All these bodies are accountable to look after the interest of education at various levels. As per law, these bodies perform various functions like to ensure quality, standards, to do new researches in the field of education. So, we will discuss the regulations and accountability mechanisms set up by these bodies. So, first is NCERT, that is National Council of Educational Research and Training. It was established in New Delhi on 1st September 1961 for providing academic support in improving the quality of school education in India. It is the academic advisor to Ministry of Human Resource Development of the Government of India. The ministry draws upon NCERT's expertise while formulating and implementing policies and programs in the area of school and teacher education. Its role is to monitor the administration of regional colleges of education, to undertake aid to promote and to coordinate research in all branches of education for improving school education, to organize pre-service and in-service education programs for the teachers, to prepare and publish study material for the students and related teachers' handbooks, to search talented students for the award of scholarship in science, technology, and social sciences, to undertake functions assigned by the Ministry of Education for improving school education, to disseminate knowledge of improved educational techniques and practices, to conduct special studies, surveys and investigation. Other body is UGC, that is University Grants Commission. UGC is a body set up in our country by the central government in 1956 to control, coordinate, determine and maintain the standards of higher education. Universities can start functioning only after getting the prior sanction and recognition of the UGC. The necessary funding is also through this body. The mandates of UGC are like promoting and coordinating university education, determining and maintaining standards of teaching, examination and research in universities, framing regulation on minimum standards of education, dispersing grants to the universities and colleges, advising the central and state governments on the measures necessary for improvement of university. Next is NAC, that is National Assessment and Accreditation Council. Its objectives are like to act as a catalytic agent to motivate higher education institutes to achieve excellence in all spheres of academic activity, to promote the idea of accountability among the academies. It is mandatory for such institutions to undergo the process of accreditation. NAC has its own regulation criteria. It has identified the following 7 criteria to serve as the basis of its assessment procedures. First is curricular aspect. Second is teaching, learning and evaluation. Third is research guidance and extension. Fourth is infrastructure and learning resources. Fifth is student support and progression. Other ones are like governance and leadership management, innovations and best practices. Role of internal quality assurance cell, that is IQAC, for performance evaluation and quality upgradation of institutions of higher education. The National Assessment and Accreditation Council proposes that every accredited institution should establish an internal quality assurance cell, that is IQAC, as a post-accreditation quality sustenance measure. Since quality enhancement is a continuous process, the IQAC will become a part of the institution system and work towards the realization of the goals of quality enhancement and sustenance. During the post-accreditation period, it will channelize all efforts and measures of the institution towards promoting its holistic academic excellence. Next is NCTE, that is National Council of Teacher Education. The mandate given to the NCTE is very broad and it covers the teacher education programs including research and training of person for equipping them to teach at pre-primary, primary, secondary and senior secondary stages in the schools. The regulations and role of the council is to coordinate and monitor teacher education and its development in the country, lay down norms for different courses of teacher education including the minimum eligibility criteria for admission, lay down guidelines for compliance by recognized institutions for starting new courses or training and for providing physical and instructional facilities, staffing pattern and staff qualification. Lay down standards in respect of examinations leading to teacher education, qualifications, criteria for admission to such examinations and schemes and of courses or training. To lay down guidelines regarding tuition fees and other fees chargeable by recognized institutions. Formulate schemes for various levels of teacher education and identify recognized institutions and set up new institutions for teacher development programs. Take all necessary steps to prevent commercialization of teacher education. Other is National University of Educational Planning and Administration, NUPA. This is apex institution concerned with educational planning and administration. This institution conducts research, organizes training, provides many services and disseminates important information on innovations, changes and developments in the areas of planning and management. Many states are also in the process of setting up state institutes of educational management and training to assist state-level educational planning and training of educational planners and administrators. Now, it's clear to you that how different bodies work in order to improve the system. So, next is regulatory frameworks at various levels like elementary, secondary and higher level. If we will talk about the elementary level, there are different types of schools like government and government aided. Second, schools run by autonomous organizations under the government such as Kendriya Vidyalaya and Navodaya Vidyalayas. Schools run by government departments directly, such as those run by defense and railways. Schools run by public sector undertakings, unaided schools and privates. On the suggestions given by the regulatory bodies and to check the process of all these elementary institutions, several initiatives were taken by the government, like the Right to Education Act 2009. The Act seeks to implement the fundamental right to education for all children, including children with disabilities between 6 to 14 years. The central RTE rules were notified on 8th April 2010. Till date, 32 states, including Gujarat, Andhra Pradesh, Himachal Pradesh, Odisha, Rajasthan, Punjab, Haryana, and Manipur, have notified state RTE rules. The government has committed 2.3 trillion for 5 years to implement the act. The fund sharing pattern between the center and the state is in the ratio of 65 to 35 for 5 years. The act makes it mandatory for all the schools to meet certain minimum norms. They have to meet the pupil teacher ratio, that is PTR. All other schools require a certificate of recognition and it shall be granted if the school satisfies certain norms such as PTR, infrastructure and qualification of teachers. Schools that do not meet these norms within the prescribed time frame shall be shut down. In case the school violates this provision, it shall be liable to fine. If we compare the regulations of government and private schools, government schools have to provide free and compulsory education to all admitted children. For aided schools, the extent of free education would be proportionate to the funding received, provided that a minimum of 25% seats are reserved for disadvantaged students. All other schools, including unaided schools, have to reserve at least 25% of seats for the students from SCs, STs, low income and other weaker groups, including children with disabilities. Unaided schools shall be reimbursed for either their tuition charge or the per student expenditure in government schools, whichever is lower. If the per student expenditure is higher than the government schools, the private school has to bear the cost. The Act prohibits physical punishment or mental harassment, screening procedures for admission of children, capitation fees, private tuitions by the teachers and running schools without recognition. It also prohibits children from being held back in class, expelled, or the requirement to pass a board examination until the completion of their elementary education. It is important to understand the extent of regulation for various types of schools. The only requirement for government school is to meet the PTR norm. However, private schools are subject to lose their recognition and shutting down if they do not comply with the norms for PTR, infrastructure and teaching. This act only specifies penalties in case a school collects capitation fees or subjects a child to a screening procedure during admission. Furthermore, the act enhances the role of all the stakeholders to ensure enrollment of all children, but does not identify which government agency will be responsible for this task. In 2008, the National Knowledge Commission, NKC, recommended the setting up of a testing body at the national level for quality assessment of both government and private schools. The testing body would monitor schools on the basis of various types of indicators such as learning levels, enrollment, and attendance. Well, if we talk about the comparison of extent of regulation for various schools, we come to know that in government schools, all admitted students should be provided with free education. In other schools, including aided and unaided, 25% seats to be reserved for disadvantaged students. For government schools, recognition is mandatory. It shall be granted if school meet norms such as PTR, infrastructure, etc. There is no strict rules regarding government schools. In case of private school operates without recognition, it shall be liable to fine. Government schools constitute school management committees with representatives. There is no provision for unaided schools. Other schools have to constitute from parents and local authority. Aided and private schools have to constitute the school management committee and play an advisory role. So, this was the primary level, and so second level is secondary and higher secondary level. Secondary and higher secondary level is the responsibility of the state governments. The proportion of private schools at secondary level is 60%. In order to give a boost to secondary education, in 2009, the central government launched the Rashtriya Madhyamik Shiksha Abhiyan, that is RAMSA. It seeks to achieve an enrollment rate of 75% within 5 years. Universal access by 2017 and universal retention by 2020. So, here it is important to know about what is the regulation procedure of secondary education. Schools are recognized by respective state departments of school education. Every recognized school which conducts a public examination at the end of classes 10th and 12th has to be affiliated with the board or councils like Central Board of Secondary Education, that is CBSE, National Institute of Open Schooling, that is NIOS, Council for the Indian School Certificate Examination, CISCE, conducting such examinations. Various committees have recommended ways to strengthen the secondary education system. These include the National Knowledge Commission, the Central Advisory Board of Education, CABE Committee's report on universalization of secondary education, and the Planning Commission's Working Group report on secondary and vocational education. Different committees give several recommendations on secondary education. Like CABE committee report said, it was focused on the universal access, equality and relevance. It enhances the flexible curriculum and scientifically designed student assessment system. It focuses on the need for decentralized micro-level planning, allocation of 6% of GDP for education. The National Knowledge Commission recommends the decentralization of school management to local authorities such as panchayats as far as possible. Transparent, norm-based procedures for the recognition of private schools to reduce harassment and bureaucratic delay. The National Evaluation Body to monitor the quality of both government and private schools using results-based monitoring framework. It mentioned the need to revamp school inspection, provide training to teachers, reform curriculum and incorporate English into the curriculum. Planning Commission report gave regulations like to extend Rashtriya Madhyamik Siksha Abhiyan Ramsa scheme to government aided schools and to cover higher secondary education. Provide for residential schools and hostels in existing schools to enhance access. Civil construction work under RAMSA should be carried out as per state schedule of rates since they vary from state to state. Provide untied fund of 10 million at the district level to improve quality in school. Next level is higher education. Education provided after completion of school education, that is after class 12th, is known as higher education, which comprises education in general subjects and others like professional and technical education. At present, India's GER, that is gross enrollment ratio, is 15% in higher education, which is much lower than the world average of 23%. The aim is to increase the GER to 21% by the end of the 12th plan and 30% by 2020. The number of unaided higher education institutions has increased over the years. Currently, 63% of institutions are private. With about 50% share in enrollment, private institutions have improved access. However, they are concentrated in a few select disciplines such as engineering, management, medicine and information technology. Also, the spread of private institutions is uneven, with some state witnessing more growth than others. UGC has the power to determine and maintain standards and to disperse grants. Universities can be central, state, private or deemed. UGC stipulates that colleges that provide degree courses have to be affiliated with the university. UGC provides minimum qualification of teacher guidelines for award of various degrees and standards that private universities have to maintain. It can also regulate fees of universities if it is in the public interest to do so, and prohibits such universities from taking any donations. Well, students, we also have to discuss about the technical and professional education. Technical education is regulated by the AICTE, and the subjects that fall under this include engineering, management, pharmacy, architecture. Technical institutions can provide degree programs only if they are affiliated with the university. Affiliation is not required if the institution runs only diploma programs. The CABE, which includes representatives from the central and state governments and other experts, coordinates between the center and the states. There are also 14 professional councils such as the Medical Council of India, the Dental Council of India, the Bar Council of India and the Council of Architecture that recognize courses, promote professional institutions and provide grants to undergraduate programs. the fees and the manner in which admission is granted in unaided institutions are regulated by the state constituted fee and admission regulatory committee, which determines the fee that each private institution can charge and the student intake. The National Assessment and Accreditation Council and the National Board of Accreditation are autonomous bodies that accredited institutions set up by the UGC and the AICTE respectively. The AICTE regulates foreign institutes which provide technical education either directly or through collaboration with Indian partners. There are many challenges facing higher education. Some of the key challenges are related to access, quality, governance and funding. Well, students, next we will talk about the several issues related to the regulation of the private sector. First is access. India's GER in higher education is about 15%. Other countries such as the United States 81%, UK, United Kingdom 54%, Japan 49% and Malaysia 27% have much higher enrollment rates. Then is the quality. No Indian university is listed in the top 100 universities in the world and only two are listed in the top 200. There are problems like universities are of poor quality, low quality of research and improper practices in admission process. Another issue is funding. Universities in India face financial constraints. Only 0.7% of India's GDP is spent on higher education, which is lower than countries such as US 22.9%, UK 1.3% and China 1.5%. In general, about 75% of maintenance expenditure is spent on salaries and pensions, and 15% is absorbed by claims such as rents, electricity, telephones, and examinations. Next is governance. India's National Policy on Education 1986 emphasized the need for decentralization, autonomy of educational institutions and the principle of accountability in managing educational institutions. The regulatory bodies have a procedure for granting recognition and there is a large-scale corruption. Next is regulation of private sector. Various Supreme Court judgments have sought to curb by ordering varying degree of control on private institutions. States such as Madhya Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh, Gujarat, Karnataka and Odisha enacted laws to set up such committees to improve the fee structure in professional educational institutions. On the other hand, the private institutes claim that capitation fee is required to ensure financial viability of the institution. Some experts also contend that allowing only non-profit entities to operate in the education sector, it does not ensure quality, nor does it increase supply or curb charging of capitation fees. The non-profit status may act as an incentive for players since such entities get tax exemptions, which makes it easier to launder money. Admission in private institutes. This is also regulated by the government. Certain number of seats are marked as government seats where students pay the equivalent of the fee charged in non-government institutes. About 15% of seats are categorized as management quota where students pay the fee as mandated by the few regulatory committee. The third constitutional amendment enables the parliament or state assemblies to enact laws reserving seats for SCs, STs, OBCs in private institutions. So, well, students, to conclude, we can say that India is graduating to an economy where the bulk of its population will be in the relatively younger age group of 20 to 35 years. This demographic dividend provides India the great opportunities but also poses a great challenge. India will be able to reap the benefits of such a dividend only if its population is healthy, educated and skilled. This chapter focused on the regulation of the education sector. India's ability to emerge as a globally competitive country will depend on its knowledge resources. There are small number of institutions that provide high quality education while the majority needs significant improvement in terms of quality, access and equity. there have been some recent initiatives to reform the sector, including the RTE Act, various bills to reform higher education regulation and schemes related to vocational education. However, many of these initiatives do not fully address issues related to quality and access of education and governance of the sector. They also do not encourage participation of the private sector in providing education. In order to bring about a systematic transformation, it is important to address many of the weaknesses and contradictions inherent in the regulatory structure of the education sector. So, students, I hope the topic is clear to you. Thank you so much for watching.